Well, welcome to Keys of the Kingdom. I'm Brother Gregory, and we're going to talk today about the Kingdom of God again, because that's what we're supposed to be preaching. The Kingdom of God is at hand, within your reach, but you actually have to reach out for it. You have to seek it. That's what Christ said. I'm not making this up. You have to seek it. You say you believe in Christ, but are you doing what he said? Because if you're not doing what he said, then you don't really believe in Christ. You have an idea in your head, and that's very close to idolatry, because you believe in your idea, but you're not actually doing what Christ said to do, which was the love it's all about. And so we ask the question, does God hate you? Because if you're not doing the will of the Father, if you're doing something absolutely contrary to the will of the Father, if you're doing something that makes the Word of God to none effect, you're actually fighting against Christ. You're going against Christ, against His way. And He is going to hate you, like Esau. And we talked earlier this morning about Esau eating the red porridge. What? Red porridge? People have tried to explain this a lot of different ways, but it's the Adama porridge. It's the flesh of your brother porridge. He's selling his birthright for benefit. Isn't that how they got into the bondage of Egypt? They sold themselves for the benefits of Pharaoh. Now, the benefits of Pharaoh in those days, Pharaoh had accumulated because he had foresight to put up huge stores of grain because he knew a famine was coming. He knew there was a famine coming because he had a dream. And he had asked Joseph what the dream meant. Now, if Joseph was still at home with his family, he would have told them, hey, there's a famine coming. And they would have prepared. They failed to prepare because they didn't know, because they had sold their brother into bondage. Have you sold your brother into bondage so that you can have benefits? Do you eat the red porridge of Esau? Because God hates Esau. Are you like the Nicolaitans? God hates the error of the Nicolaitans in the ways of Balaam. Now, I saw in a couple of articles that went out, one, they talk about Ron and Carol being Ron Paul and one of their granddaughters left the GOP convention, which this author refers to as the snake pit, yesterday afternoon. And they went to get onto an airplane in Clearwater, and 8 TSA agents descended upon them and ordered them not to board the private plane. Why? Because there was a presidential candidate Romney in the area, and they were worried that the plane could be used as a bomb. This is Ron Paul's plane. The pilot made a comment. He says, well, full of fuel, the whole plane's a bomb. But evidently, Carol refused to cooperate, and they eventually started backing off. But, I mean, it's ridiculous. It's absurd. There's a number of absurd stories that I see going on today. And these could be great distractions, and I don't want to mention them because of the distracting aspect of the story. But there was a story of a fellow who's in prison, I think it was up in Massachusetts. He thought he was a girl, so he started having a sex change operation and taking injections, hormones, etc., and everything. But during this period of time, he also got married to a woman. And during the course of his marriage, decided that he needed to kill her and did so. And was caught and convicted. But because he's now in prison, he hasn't been able to finish his sex change operation, and he wants the taxpayers to pay for it. And so he sued for his right to be a woman, which is like a Monty Python skit. You can't have baby. You don't have a womb. So, and it's kind of funny. You have to love English humor in order to enjoy it. But the fact is that this is real life. And a judge rules that he has the right to force you, the taxpayers, to pay for his operation. And they go on there, and the state is contesting this, and they're going to fight it in court and appeal it. And they said that they hope that common sense will eventually rule out, overrule the situation and win out. Well, what's going to happen is lawyers are going to get rich in this battle. Why is there even a discussion of the matter? It's insane that your society has become insane. And not just in those ways, in many ways, many more subtle ways. In an article by Chuck Baldwin, he's quoting someone by the name of Skousen, who wrote, and he agreed with him to some degree, the sagacity of his article. He says his condensed version of what had been written was that people in America are no longer worthy of liberty. Americans are lazy about finding the truth. They are interested in being entertained, even on our own network. Any of the people who have joined the network, like some email group, you know, entertain me. You know, give me something to read because I'm bored. They aren't seeking the kingdom. They aren't interested in seeking the kingdom. They're seeking self-righteousness, want to feel self-righteous. And we see that in some of the posts of some of the people. And we have no power over, you know, who comes on to the groups. But we do have some power over the fact that if someone is not there on the group for the purpose of the group and they start disrupting things, we can moderate them. You know, we don't moderate them in the rest of the world, but just on the groups that we created. It's just like I build a porch, and you can come on my porch, knock on the door and come in. But if you misbehave and start disrupting the family, we're going to kick your end out of the porch. You're not going to be on the porch. We built the porch. You can have the rest of the world to go and create your disruption, but you're not allowed to come in and disrupt our family. And we have a purpose, and it's well published. We're seeking the kingdom of God and His righteousness. If you want to do that too, you can join the email network. Now, when you join the email network, you have successfully joined an email network. That's it. That's all you've done. That's all you've accomplished. You aren't necessarily seeking the kingdom yet. You're just seeking to be on an email network. Now, if you want to get anywhere on that network, you have to actually connect with somebody who can see who's on the group. And they're on the personal contact minister group. They're connected with all the other personal contact ministers. And some of the men who do that, and some of the women who do that, actually connect with each other, get to know each other, talk with each other, drive all the way over to other states and visit with them, come to the Burning Bush Festival, our fall festival, and have come to other meetings, like in Missouri. And they've got to meet each other, and they talk about kingdom, and they think about kingdom, and they discuss kingdom, and they discuss what this gospel of the kingdom was all about. And they interact with one another, and then they go back to their local areas in Tennessee and in Missouri and in Wisconsin and Illinois and the different places that they are located, and they will be a focal point where if you want to connect with other people, they have the list of who else is on the groups. And if you want to share your information with them, they'll have that. And if they find more people, they will connect you two together. And if you come together on this network with the intention of helping one another, not consuming one another, not eating out the substance of one another, but helping one another, then that spirit will begin to bear fruit. But if you think you can do like the world where you just, you know, elect somebody and sit back and let him do everything, it's not going to happen. And I told some stories about sheep on Blog Talk just before the show. You can go listen to it. how they naturally gather together in a network, out in the fields, out on the range, and they learn to stick together. And it only works not because they have authoritarian leaders or TSA officers going around checking on everybody or any of that. It works because every member of the flock works at staying together. They keep track of their leader. You'll see them grazing. One sheep, next one, just evenly spaced right next to it. You know, and if they're really out in strange and dangerous area, they'll actually be touching each other. And then the next one, and the next one, and the next one, right in a row. And each one slightly behind the leader and the one next to it. You know, like a flock of geese flying. And they organize themselves that way. Geese are a perfect example. Natural networks in society that serve a purpose. It would take a physicist to figure out that if we fly right in this formation because of the wind as they travel, it would be slightly easier for each one behind. And there's a leader out there. Did they elect him? It's something natural that he ended up as leader. A little bit stronger flyer. Because he's going to get the full force of the flight. And there's nobody helping him. And he's actually will feel a little drag of the group behind him. But then after a while, if you watch the geese flying, sometimes the leader will drop back and take another position where it's not so hard to fly. You won't be in the front. This is the same way in the congregations of record. You will need each other, but you need to have a huge network of independent people that come together not for what they will receive, not for the red porridge benefits that they will get, but because they want to give. It's in their nature. Each of you are leaders in that giving. Each of you must choose to give accordingly to help one another. That early church was the entire social welfare system of Christians. There were all kinds of welfare systems around at that time. Rome had them. Judea had them. But they actually worked together to form a social network based on faith, hope, and charity. When Skosin, I'm not sure how to pronounce his name, but anyway, he said that Americans are too lazy in finding the truth. Chuck Baldwin writes, "My take differs only slightly from Skosin's. I believe when the crisis comes, people will not be able to relocate." He's talking about get out of the cities, which is why the Lord is inspiring people to relocate now, and why the gathering of the eagles is already taking place here in Montana, Flathead Valley, and in other places. The problem is that many of those people that are escaping the cities now are just fleeing out of fear and anxiety. And some of them are maybe coming for the right reason. Maybe they're actually following the Spirit of God in their hearts. But that isn't the way that the early church operated. Now, certainly the early church was helping one another. We see that when there was a dearth in the land, that there was people who gathered up funds and sent it by way of the church ministers to help people out who were having trouble all over because of economic difficulties and shortages and famines and what have you. They were a network of charity. They were not eating of each other's flesh. They were freely giving. They saw that they had no coat, or they had not enough food, or they needed assistance, and they shared. This was the message of John the Baptist. Share. Not just get wet in baptism, but actually share. Freely, willingly, efficiently, in a network of charity. That's what they were doing. They were feeding each other willingly. Here, eat of my flesh. I give it freely. I give you a portion of the sweat of my brow to take care of your needs, because I see you have a true need. If I see you not have a true need, I won't give to you. The world will give to you whether you have a true need or not. This is what's going on out there. People who are promiscuous and have children by half a dozen different people, they're paid. They're given money. They're on the government welfare. There was government welfare in the days of Moses, but it was based on free will offerings. And it was provided by the Levites, who were tied to according to their service. And they helped out the widows and orphans, the needy of their society. But in the days of Herod, they had turned that system of welfare into a compelled system of welfare where you had to pay in. Everybody had to pay in. So at first it seems like, okay, if everybody has to pay in, we can provide these benefits and I don't have to pay in as much. I won't have to give as much because everybody's going to pay their fair share. And it sounds good at first, it's a compulsory offering. But what happens is that the powers that can force those offerings begin to squander. They become not shepherds, but predators. And this is what we were talking about with the sheep. The range sheep, who freely roam on the range. Like I said, our gates are not shut. They're just out there. They can walk out the gate anytime they want. And before, when we had some farm flock sheep mixed in with them, they sometimes did. But they roam around. They go together. They stick together. They go this way around this creek, and then they go across this bridge, and then they go over to the sweet clover, and then they come back around, and then they go up in the hill. And they, who's the leader? How are they knowing where to go? Why are they all together all the time? They've learned to, because they're free-ranging sheep. They're not farm flocks. You put a farm flock out in the field, they'll be all over the place. They won't be sticking together. What some sheepmen call those as woolly pigs, because they are like pigs. You see? There's analogies in these. They know the pigs won't stick together. They just are interested in filling their belly. So, but the point was is that in Israel and Judea, at that time, they helped one another far away from them. But they were still in Jerusalem till the day that the Romans surrounded Jerusalem on all four sides, encompassed them round about. And then they left. And of course, the Jews wouldn't let them take anything out. They'd throw John off the wall, and they were really against Christians. They hated Christians, which were simply followers of Christ, Jews who were following Christ, those in Judea, especially in Jerusalem. And those people just went up to the Jews that were there and said, "We want to leave. Here's the deed to my house. Here's my treasure. Here's all my gold. Here's all my silver. Here's all my clothes. Everything is in the house. It's yours. You guys can have it, all the food, it's yours. I just want to go out the door." And they said, "Okay, be gone." And another one went, and another one went. And many, many of them went, according to Josephus, came out of the city of Jerusalem with nothing but the clothes on their back. And people couldn't believe that. And some people swallowed gold coins in order to get them out, and the Jews actually cut their bellies open to get the gold out. And they didn't survive. And Romans were ordered not to do that. Because anybody who came out with nothing like that in their hands, just let them go free. They just had a free ticket to go. Where'd they go? They're having to leave their homes, their wealth, everything. They left it all behind. Where'd they go? They went into the womb and hands of the rest of the Christian network. And they knew where they were because they had been giving to one another for 30 years since the days of Christ, almost 40 years since the days of Christ, helping one another in times of need. They had created a well-disciplined network of charity, bound together by love alone. Can you imagine that? Not bound together by ideologies and theologies and eschatologies and doctrines of men, but by the doctrine of Christ. Love one another as I have loved you. What did Jesus do to love you? He fed you. He freed you. This is the flesh of Christ. Are you loving one another? Are you freeing one another? Or are you too lazy to seek out the truth? So the question is, does God hate you? Are you selling your birthright like Esau for that pot of red porridge benefit at the expense of your neighbor? At the expense of your brother? Well, then God hates you. Have you become a conquered people? Balaam, Nicolaitan, both mean the same thing. The error is that they go into bondage like the days of Egypt. They reject God. They elect Sauls. And they go into bondage. And they become subjects. Not free sheep on the range, but farm flocks, fenced in, bound in by a fence of their own making. We need to turn around. We need to stop being too lazy to find the truth. And we need to actually seek out that truth and go another way. Another news item that is part of the same theme, almost everything is a part of the theme of seeking the kingdom, but this particular one this week was from something sent to us. Actually, it was sent to me by a number of different people. But a lady by the name of Annie in Colorado wrote some scathing comments about the right to vote. And she says, do you know when things really started to go literally to hell in this country? When women were given the right to vote, separate and apart from their husband. What a flipping disaster. She writes this. The war against marriage and the family began in earnest. It didn't begin there, she's admitting that, but it began in earnest. And it was taken less than 100 years for both institutions to be almost completely destroyed. And it all started with the damn suffrage. This is her words I'm quoting here. Here's the deal. Up until women's suffrage, a man was the head of his marriage and his household. And his vote represented not just himself, but his entire family, including his wife and his children. When men voted, they were conscious of the fact that they were voting not just for themselves and their own personal interests, but they were also charged with the responsibility of discerning and making the ultimate decision about what is in the heart and the best interest of the entire family. Isn't that nuts? When men being responsible. Of course, they aren't all responsible, but real men are responsible. Males are not always responsible. They don't think with their heart and love of their wives and their families. They think with love of self. And this, of course, is not Christian. This is not the ways of Christ. Ways of Christ as you would be decided. But she thinks that this country went to on this path to hell when women were given the right to vote, when the reality is we can take it back, when men were given the right to vote, because if you read in Samuel, it says that the voice of the people, when they voted to have a king, chose to have a king, were desirous of a king, elected a king, that they were on their way back to the bondage of Egypt. And that makes it very clear that they would take and take and take and take and even take your daughters and sons away from you. And all that has happened because men were given the right to vote. So it wasn't just women, but I see her point. It's not the whole kingdom perspective because men shouldn't even have the right to vote. Now, how do you run a government? Well, it's back to that seeking the kingdom, a government of righteousness, Christian government. You don't, your vote is your tithe. You choose the man you think is a good leader, doing righteousness, working daily to accomplish righteousness in your community, and you help them out. And it may be with the money. It may be with just some help. And maybe you'll make some phone calls, or you'll become an assistant. It's your responsibility. How and when and what you do to seek the kingdom, not just for yourself, but for others. And the kingdom of God is the right to be ruled by God. And you don't have the right to be ruled by God if you ask other men to rule over your neighbor. That man, if you give him the power to rule over your neighbor, you will also give him the power to rule over you. Then you will not be free. And how do you choose that man? You choose him by vote. You vote in this man to exercise authority one over the other. And guess what? You're trapped in the same net that you set to trap your neighbor. And how do they bind you in this? You eat at their table. True Christians should have a table of which they cannot eat. Because you can't eat things sacrificed to idols. Which is where, what was things sacrificed to idols? It was to provide the benefits of those temples. And to you, the voice of the people, whether men or women, you know, by giving women the right to vote, you divided the family, and that's true. But by giving men the right to vote, you divided society. You separated society. Now society was at war with each other. Democrats against Republicans. Red against Greens. That's the way it was in Rome. Reds and Greens. They warred against each other in sports and everything. And they divided them, and the conquerors of the people, the Nicolaitan philosophy of conquering the people by offering them gifts, gratuities, and benefits, won out. And Rome went from a free republic to an imperial dictatorship. And every country that seeks to force its neighbor to provide the welfare of its society, instead of doing like John the Baptist and Jesus said, to provide it out of love and pure religion. Everyone who goes that way of forcing their neighbor, coveting their neighbor's goods to the agency of government, is doomed. And you can't do anything about it. They're doomed. Moving out of the cities is not the solution. The Christians stayed in the city. Some of them did. Stayed in the city until the last day. And when they came out, they had a place to go. Their riches were not in their house or in their treasury or in the gastophone. It was in their community of people who actually understood the message of Christ about self-sacrifice for one another and were willing to build not a stone temple with a stone here and a stone there and another stone slightly offset and build this big, huge stone temple. They built a living stone temple of people and relationships that were created because people would drive 500 miles, 1,000 miles to sit down and talk kingdom, to organize themselves. And that's what we're doing. We're seeking the kingdom. And we're seeking it together because we are not going to be forsaking the gathering together. This is the custom of some. How many people have started a congregation of records at the last minute said, oh no, I don't think we need to gather together. We've got our little congregation here, maybe. That's what some do. They get their little congregation over here in Poughkeepsie. And they say, well, we got our congregation. You know, we get our sense of fellowship. And I see this out in the field. When we were driving down to the field the other day, there was two black-faced sheep, lambs, over with three other white-faced sheep. And they were spread out away from the rest of the flock. And I called out to them, hey! Which is, I'm not going to yell as loud as I yell. Or have a sound dials going off. But I yelled this noise that they know. And they all looked up. and they got closer together to each other. And there were some other sheep on the other side that were also away from the main herd, and you could see them trotting down through the sagebrush to get back to the main herd. This little group just came together as a little group. It didn't go join the rest. Oh, the coyotes just love those kinds of sheep. They'll get them and they'll run right into them and they'll scatter because they're a little tiny flock of five sheep, and one of them is going to end up to be a meal. Or two. But they're pretty heavy sheep. But, and I've seen it before. Now these guys eventually, a couple more hollers and I could see them starting to move down. But that's because they're learning. The ones that didn't learn end up being coyote hors d'oeuvres. And I see this happening with people all the time. They're divided. They have these little ministers, these pastors who say, oh, well, we've got our little congregation. I got my little congregation. And they're not networking with anybody else, except for people who have their same eschatology. I only love those who have my eschatology. Tell me this, did the Good Samaritan and the guy in the ditch have the same eschatology? Doctrines? Isn't that the excuse that the Pharisee used to walk around the man in the ditch and to leave him there? Not our eschatology. Not our doctrine. None of our business. But the Good Samaritan didn't say, oh, excuse me, sir, what's your eschatology? Before I help you, I want to know that you're a part of our church. If that is the Good Samaritan, why aren't your congregations gathering together with other congregations? All we're doing is gathering to be there for one another. You need to do that before you run off to your Montana wilderness refuge. If you don't have that, I don't want you coming here. If you aren't coming out of love for one another, don't bother coming, because the Spirit of Christ is not in you. Spirit of saving yourself is in you. Spirit of escaping the woes of the world are in you, but not the love of Christ. Not the flesh and blood of Christ. Because he didn't come to save himself. If you're going to Montana to save yourself, forget it. It's not that you're too lazy. It's that you're too foolish to seek the truth in the ways of Christ. Are you sacrificing daily? Do you give up some time, some energy, something today for the good of other people, even people you don't even know? Is that what you're doing? Or are you... You know, some people say, well, I'm not a part of the system. You mean you don't pay into the system. But do you pay into Christ's system? You see, so many people, I've seen over the years, because we write about government, we write about, you know, the covenants of God, we tell why you owe the income tax, and you owe it, pay it. And we show how the church should be separate. You know, not a... 5 and 10, 23 form church. You should be a free church under God alone. The church is separate. That's no surprise. They write about it. You can find out more about the church being separate by reading the IRS pamphlet than you can by reading the eschatology of the most churches. They have become a wicked bunch in most of these churches. A woman writes, goes on, Annie writes, as soon as the 19th Amendment was passed, men were effectively castrated and in many, many cases disenfranchised by their wives. No longer was the man the head of the household. No longer was he responsible for his wife. Now the wife was a co-husband at best, or a flat-out adversary at worst. the nation of man making a final decision about what was best for his wife and family per his God-given vocation as husband and father was now over. Now all he was good for was bringing home the bacon. But even that wouldn't last. She goes on to say that women are made with healthy innate desire to provide for and protect the family. I know this because I am a woman, she says. She goes on to say, Satan has used this healthy feminine dynamic, perverted by suffrage, to systematically replace men with the government as the provider in society. A woman no longer has any need of a man. Marriage no longer serves any practical purpose. A woman can whore around and have as many fatherless children as she pleases. And pimp daddy government will always be there to provide. Men have learned well from this too. Men can also slot it up to their heart's content, knowing that the government will take care of the women and raise their children for them. Fathering children no longer binds a man to a woman in any way. Men didn't vote to societal castrate themselves and never would have. No, in order for the system to have come about, women's suffrage was an absolute necessity. Women themselves voted the system into place, which objectifies and devalues both them and their children. So this one's pretty outspoken. He says, for you men who don't like my position, you're just a slave to political correctness. Anyway, what's happened is that we've become members of a gigantic family, a gigantic religious order, under a vow of poverty. Nothing we own belongs to us anymore. We only have legal title. They can take away as much as they want because their order, the leaders of their order, exercise authority one over the other. They provide you with lots of benefits, but at what cost? Cost of freedom under God. Responsibility requires your effort. And you cannot have your rights back without taking back your responsibility. And if you're going to be the government of God, you're going to have to network as a people. You're going to have to connect with one another in a systematic way. I can take the finger bones of a hand and I can spread them around on the desert. I can take the bones of the feet, the five metacarpals, the phalanges, the tibia, the fibula, the femur bone, and scatter them around on the desert so that they're all disjointed and not connected. But that's not a body. That's scattered bone. If you're going to have that body come together, it has to come together in a system. Can those bones come together in a system? Called a body, a skeletal structure? Can flesh come onto those bones? Can you breathe life into those bones? Well, you can't, but God can. You can choose to be a part of that body. Or you can choose to reject that body and stay a scattered flock. You have lots of ministers who want to keep you a scattered flock. They want to keep you in their congregation. They want to keep you a member of their little group. They don't want you to be free and independent. They want you to be their congregation. This is my congregation. This is my church. That's not what you should be doing. You should be doing something completely different. So does God hate you? God wants to love you. He wants you to love Him. And if you love Him, you'll do His way. You will be like the Good Samaritan, taking care of one another. Not because you have the so-called right eschatology, because you're a righteous individual. Obviously, you're not supposed to be out there helping drug addicts stay drug addicts. which a lot of charities do. You know, a drug addict, he loses everything, spends all his welfare check on drugs, he has his party, goes around and fathers children, and then he's broke. But he can go to the mission, and the mission will feed him, and they will shelter him and get him through the next month so that he can start the process all over again when his welfare check shows up. And they call that charity. I'm sorry, folks, that's not charity. That's murder. You're killing that man and killing his soul. He needs to fall flat on his face and decide to repent. You know, there's a dissonance that takes place. Dissonance is aroused in the hearts and minds of people when they are confronted with information that is inconsistent with their beliefs. And people believe that they believe in Christ. And they believe that they're doing what Christ said. But they're actually doing the opposite. They're doing what makes the Word of God to none effect. Cognitive dissonance is basically when one believes a reality collides with another reality, another fact, another piece of information that they didn't have. The pagan temples of Rome was the supplier of the welfare of Rome that took care of the widows and orphans and needy of their society. That's what those pagan temples were doing. And they were supported by government money. They registered birth certificates in the Temple of Saturn so that they would know who was eligible for benefits. Now, originally, Augustus provided a lot of those benefits. There were some groups in Rome that were still trying to get back to this faith, hope, and charity that had made Rome great. It wasn't their constitution that made them great. It wasn't their system of electing senators and their system of senators electing a president. A principis civitas, first citizen, president of Rome, and eventually the commander-in-chief of Rome, they called the emperor. That's what wasn't what made the nation great. It was the fact that they came together and helped one another, and protected one another, and provided for one another. And family was at the core of that, the heart of the family. And the women were revered because they kept the home fires burning in the hearth to provide healthy families, healthy sons and daughters, independent sons and daughters, who had this same sense, this gregarious sense of community. And if anybody was robbed, they came out with a hue and cry. If anybody was abused, they came out to their defense. Justice was what they had loyalty to. A sense of justice. We don't have that anymore. Our loyalty is to our benefactors who exercise authority one over the other. And Christ said we weren't to be like that. We were to have benefactors of the church that did not exercise authority. Because we were not to be like the benefactors of the world government. We were to be the government of God that took care of one another out of faith, hope, and charity. It's as simple as that. And you don't take care of one another in your churches out of faith, hope, and charity. And if you have a congregation that supposedly does that, are you connected with 100 other congregations doing the same thing? Are you tithing only to your minister, your little isolated congregation, your little scattered flock on the hillside that's not a part of the whole flock? I will hear you squeal when the coyotes come to your door because you have abandoned Christ in His church. His church, I don't have control over His church. I'm just telling you what it looks like. If you haven't found that yet, if you haven't become that yet, then you're not in his church. It's his church, it's not my church. But what it looks like is people caring about one another in congregations that have gone on record and saying, we're caring about these guys here, and we care about all these other congregations that are connected with us. And connected by what? Our honor, our work.